Welcome to Quarantine. With yours truly, Garry. This is the BPRC, Black People's Republic of China. This is where you get all the opinions of living abroad, or my opinion. And you get the experience of living across waters without going there.
I need me a thick chick.
This is for the travelers.
I'm going through my Netflix. Fourth in the motherfucker.
The people who just want to know what it's like.
Make it shake like Nesquik. Neck frozen with nowhere to go, bitch. Popping COD on the PS4.
This is part of what we are.
Refrigerator doors. We can heat up some
money. Born in the goddamn house.
Can't even go on tour. Nigga so bored, I'm losing my mind. Bang. All these girls tell them one at a time. Nigga still hating, tell them catch me outside.
And that will be the most beneficial part of being in quarantine, is being allowed to talk to yourself, right? Entertain, there's nothing else to do. Well, there are some other things to do, like progress and learn and things like that. But this is fun, this is entertaining, right? Get it off my mind. Today's topic is going to be integrate society. How to integrate society when you move across the waters or you move across the land. You have to learn how to infuse yourself into that particular society, wherever you live. For me, it was China, right? So this topic is gonna be pretty much about just finding a secure place, right? So when you move across water, wherever you go, living abroad, for me, it was China. Being Black is hard in your own nation, but being Black in another nation, particularly a nation that doesn't really have a lot of experience with dealing with Black folks, whether you're from Africa or America or wherever you are, right? Because different personalities based off your environment, right? We're all products of our environment, so we're different in that sense. But it's really important to understand that you must find your secure place, meaning your spiritual safety and your safe haven for emotional stress, because you're going to get to a place, no matter where you live in the beginning, until you get acclimated completely, you're going to be in an emotional state. Doesn't mean you're gonna cry or be sad or be depressed, but you're going to start missing things that you're used to, right? So for me, it was grooming. It was just the ability to communicate with people, just pick up the phone and call someone. The language, right? Just missing the conversational piece. Because in the beginning, if you don't know the language, you know, you're going to have to find a way to communicate to folks that isn't, you're not going to be able to talk at the right speed, at your normal speed. Almost like dumbing down your native tongue, you know, and almost forgetting your native tongue because you have to learn that tongue. So like learning Chinese is not easy. It's very difficult. So it took a while to even just get the tones. And I still don't even really get the tones, but I'm sufficient. put it that way. So the question would be is how to integrate with a new culture. My suggestion would be first, find yourself someone in the culture that can speak your language and the native tongue. Right. And just find a small circle of folks like that who just want to help you integrate faster, or want to help you just kind of get set up, because living abroad, man, it's not as easy as, oh, I'm going to go live there, I'm going to make friends, everything's cool. It's about opening up bank accounts, learning how the currency works, learning how to transfer and receive the currency, you know, buying food, ordering food, what to order, how to read the language so that, you know, you don't die from diabetes or whatever underlying health issues you have. You have to make sure you know how to take care of that. Go to the hospital, tell the people, the nurses and the doctors, what you want that don't speak your language. So the first thing I would say was find someone who can help you, someone that can be like your assistant almost, you know, but also your friend, because that person is someone that you're probably going to have a long lasting friendship with forever. You know, another thing I would say to integrate into the new culture is immediately start learning words. Get your vocabulary up. I wouldn't necessarily get straight into learning the language or how to speak sentences yet. I would just build my vocabulary. That way, when you hear words, you can kind of use your common sense and body language to understand what's being said, if you can pick up on certain words, you know. So that's what that's those would be the two main things. Let me see, what else would they be? What else would they be? I really can't say. Well, what I did was get yourself a go on walks or ride bikes or go for a run. But when you run, don't run in the gym. Go outside, because that's how you're going to learn your neighborhood. And by learning your neighborhood, one thing you can do by learning your neighborhood and walking around is you can allow yourself to be visible. And by allowing yourself to be visible, what you do is you allow the neighbors and the people in the community who have been living there their whole life to get used to you. And then once they get used to you, there's really nothing you can't do, because everybody just wants to help you. You know, that's one thing I find about living abroad. I'm not sure it's the same as for foreigners coming to America, but living abroad for sure, in my experience, if they feel like you have a good spirit, or, you know, you're a good person, everybody wants to help you, you know, just because they want to show you what their life is like. You know, they're real excited about showing you what their life is like and helping you understand their culture. So those would be my main points to integrating into a new culture, no matter where you live. For me, it was China, but no matter where you move to, it's pretty much the same three things, just, you know, maybe different elements. You know, for example, in China, there's no cash, right? So everything's on the phone. So you got to get your phone set up ASAP. As soon as you land, you got to get your phone set up so that you can even navigate maps and taxis and everything. Everything's by the phone. And the second part of that would be, that's integrating into the new culture. But the second part of that, which relates to me, is people don't realize that when you leave a country, when you live in a country for more than, I would say more than 2 years, I would say three at least, you become part of that community, right? But then when you have to come home, there's a somewhat of like a trauma factor in leaving your comfort zone, right? I wouldn't say safety, but leaving your comfort zone and integrating back into your own culture. People don't realize it's more difficult than you would expect. Like, what I'm finding out is that you have to you have to figure out real quick where you belong, because there's nothing you do after living abroad for 3 years that you're used to, that you can just jump back into, right? The people aren't the same. Well, maybe they're the same, but they don't look at you the same. You know, for example, maybe watching TV is different. Maybe you're used to when you went abroad, you watched TV for learning. Now you got to come back and watch TV and figure out what shows are even good, or maybe TV doesn't seem the same to you anymore. Coming home and figuring out, you know, your old friends don't meet your expectations anymore. So maybe you don't want the same circle of friends because you're used to the circle of friends that you had. And maybe you changed yourself a little bit. Now, when you come back, you want to remain who you were, but society doesn't allow you to, because things in your home country are not the same, right? So that those things are traumatic and can be very depressive for individuals. And just for myself, I wouldn't say it hasn't been traumatic, like very traumatizing, but it has been enjoyable in some senses and difficult at some times too, because you have to really just take a step back and look and say, oh man, now I gotta force myself to reintegrate into original society and behave this, like, this part of the world wants me to behave, you know. All meanwhile, it's still the expat in you is still inside, you know. It's interesting. That's why I say enjoyable, because there'll be moments when you'll be again and again. All of this is based off of being quarantined and kind of just being in the house all the time. And, you know, I live alone. So being in the house all the time and having limited contact with folks, you really just get to have like little visions, and little things will happen to you. And you'll be like, oh, man, had I been here, I would never do that. You know, so it's pretty enjoyable. It's fun to see. I should write a book about it. But that's all I really wanted to give you guys, is let you know that if you are dealing with, or if you are thinking about moving abroad, just know that you're going to go through things when you first land. And when you come back, there's going to be safety needs met, and there's going to be security needs that you need, right? And if you have been in that experience, I'm pretty sure you understand exactly what I'm talking about. This is a different world. You know, we're kind of like, once you leave the country and you live somewhere for a few years, you're kind of like the forgotten citizen almost. You know, for example, like the stimulus package. Nobody's talking about the people who have left the country for years, haven't paid taxes because we haven't had to, because we don't have jobs on the books, to coming back here now to not being able to receive stimulus checks because we haven't paid taxes, right? These are all traumatizing factors in living abroad, you know. But let's move on from that, and let's go to a caller. Let's see if I can get someone who has been in the situation as I have. Let's call Marcques and see if Marcques can share some insight on his experience. He also lived in Shanghai with me, moving back to the States. Let's see, Marcques. Mr. Marcques.
Hey, how are you?
Man, I'm doing good. You are live on the BPRC, the Black People's Republic of China. And here we just kind of talk about living abroad, specifically Black people moving to China or living in China. But it is everywhere. It's not just China, and it's not just Black. So wanted to give you a call because you were there with me. How are you today, sir?
Doing great. Yourself?
Yeah, man, everything's good. So today we're talking about integrating society. And I was giving the listeners my perspective on, and it's fair to say that I should tell the listeners that you are a doctor, so psychology, and you're very intelligent. So I'd like to get your opinion on this. Integrating society and what it's like when you first move abroad, finding a secure place, like your safety net, and then when you come home, the trauma that it may give you from reintegrating society. Can you just talk about your thoughts on that a little bit from your experiences?
Yeah, thank you for having me on, Garry. I'm not quite a doctor, almost.
No, you're a doctor, brother. We're gonna call that out into fruition. You're a doctor.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you. You know, living abroad, you know, comes with obviously some challenges. You know, how another culture is gonna respond, particularly, you know, in the case of Black or, you know, African American, or maybe from whatever country, maybe another African country. You know, if you've grown up in America for length of time, or been in America for length of time, you know that we've all probably faced some challenges based really on the fact of the color of our skin. So, going to a completely different culture environment where, you know, you have over a billion people, let's say, in China, that, you know, all look different from it's definitely an interesting, you know, endeavor.
So what did you find, like, what were some things that you found maybe the most difficult when you first moved? I'm talking about when you first got integrated into China society, because you were, how long were you living in China?
About 6.5 years.
All right, and then where, did you live anywhere else outside of China?
No, I didn't. That was the first place I stopped outside of the U.S.
Okay, so what were like some of the difficult things for you integrating into a new culture? Like I told the viewers earlier that for me, it was just learning how to communicate and find that balance of a network, of a circle, you know what I mean? Because when you first get there, you can't really communicate. And then so then you don't really have like real friends, you know what I mean? So it's like, it's pretty lonely in the beginning.
Yeah, I mean, I guess for me, I think the hardest part for me, honestly, the first part was the food. excited actually when I was in China because I was like, oh, this is amazing Chinese food. Soon to find out that our definition of Chinese food and their Chinese definition
is completely different.
The first time I sat down at a restaurant and they brought out the food, I didn't even know what that was. I was like, man. So I think that was the first initial challenge for me.
Right.
I was fortunate to, kind of, have a small group of, with a small group of international people. And I think, the thing about integrating into China is that, you quickly find out that, you are a foreigner. Like if you were to come to the U.S., because it's so diverse, there wouldn't be a clear distinction between, you wouldn't know a person walking down the street if they were from America or they were from, Honduras.
Right.
You just imagine. But when you're in China, it's a clear delineation between you being a foreigner and not being Chinese.
So right.
I think that's the first thing. Since, I think just the way things are done in China, it's kind of a difference. I mean, I think my first experience was with banking and how slow the banking process was. And I think it's adapting to the cultural differences.
When you say banking, you mean like the waiting time or the actual sit down time?
Yeah, like I mean, I remember the first time I went to the bank, minus the fact that I think at that time, this guy had never seen a black person speak. He got up from across the room, walked all the way across, and touched my skin to see if I was real.
I had that done as well, especially in the bank. People don't realize, man, like, well, not even in the bank, but everywhere. If you run into a Chinese person, let's just say you run into a Chinese person at the bank and they've never seen a black person before, the first thing that happens is like a shock thing. So they freeze. So now they didn't even remember why they're helping you, is because now they're so excited about, oh my God, I met a black person. Like that cuts down the time too,
Yeah.
That's so true.
I think one of the challenges is obviously that there's such distinct language barrier between English or even Spanish. You can pick up Spanish, you can pick up like Chinese is such a difficult language initially. You find that communication, there are things, we're lucky, fortunate if I was living in Shanghai, but, you still find that, there are people obviously that speak English, but being able to communicate exactly what you're trying to convey and having that understood, I think the biggest communication challenge is Chinese people sometimes will say they understand what you're saying, but they have no clue what you just said.
Right.
You'll speak, they'll be like, yeah, I speak English. And you'll say something, and they'll be like, yeah. But they'll be like, they'll actually have no clue. And so you have one expectation. In actuality, they'll be like, oh, how can you get to this place? And they'll be like, with face, they'll be like, oh, go here.
Yeah. And don't even know where they're sending you. And it's clear to say, let me say, I love my Chinese people, you know what I mean? And that's what makes me love them, is because, like, that right there, where it's like, it's frustrating, but at the same time, it's like childish. It's like, you know what I mean? It's like being around a child when a child makes a mistake and it's kind of funny, but they're a child, so you let it slide. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I appreciate them stepping up to try to help, but sometimes I can.
Yeah, it's more hindering. So now with that being said, now you let us know about the challenges that you face integrating into the culture. Now, what about the challenges that you face coming back home after 6 years because of the virus, and because you're back in the States now, right?
Yeah.
So what challenges have you come up with in terms of coming back home out of that situation from 6 years? Because for me, I just find myself like, for instance, I said, for TV, when I watch TV here, I'm like, what am I watching? Like, I almost feel like, why am I watching this? Because, in China, we don't watch TV. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So, yeah. So go ahead and give me your side. Like, what's your thoughts?
Well, you know, I just arrived here like on Saturday, so I haven't necessarily been back home. After they said the coronavirus didn't follow me, after I was in China, I was in Italy for about 2 weeks, then I was in Germany, then I was in Poland for about a month and a half.
But, oh, God.
So actually, I just got back into the States, and I think one of the things about coming back into the States is, you know, you're faced with, you know, I had mixed emotions about getting on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's, after being abroad for so long, it's like there was a lot of benefits to living abroad.
Right.
The interesting strength time, the ability to just pick up every, you know, throughout the week and fly to another country, you mm-hmm. know, because you were so close to something else, experience another culture, you know, just that kind of like international lifestyle. You know, it was like maybe when I was getting on the plane, I felt like, wow, am I giving that up, you know, coming back home? And that was maybe some of the initial trepidation in terms of me actually making the decision to take that last charter flight out of home, because it was like one the borders were closed, and I know we're in an unprecedented time in the world in terms of this modern era, in terms of what we're facing with the coronavirus.
Right.
But, you know, as I hopped on that, I had a decision. Did I want to stay in Poland, or did I want to, you know, come on back to the U.S.? And I felt myself torn on my travels from Poznan to Warsaw, this conflict and this battle in my mind about, you know, just that feeling of I was this foreigner. And yeah, at times it was challenging, but at times there was a lot of advantages. It was kind of an exciting lifestyle I was afforded to do a lot of things that I had dreamed or wanted to do. So I think maybe initially, I think some of the challenge coming home was just dealing with the reality that, oh, I'm no longer abroad. But then I had to kind of reframe my thinking and think, well, there's nothing that stops me from ever going back, you know? And I think that transition has been kind of maybe the initial shock. But yeah, you know, I don't know necessarily, because we're in a different time. You know, we're in a
right.
different time where, you know, we have social distancing, we have, you know, the job market was booming, and now, you know, it's basically come to a standstill.
A standstill.
You know, around the world. So, you know, I guess it might not be, you know, it might not be a true representation of what I might actually feel if I came back in a time where, you know, everything was copacetic, everything was running, functioning as normal, but we would come back at an abnormal time, you know, around the world.
I think that's interesting, and what you say is so true. Just because when you come home, you know, it's interesting what you said in terms of we're in different times, but it's mixed emotions about coming home, because, like you said, that, you know, when people don't realize, unless you've lived abroad, you don't know what that feeling is like, and it could be it's either a wonderful experience to where like you almost don't want to ever leave, or it's a terrible experience and you can't wait to get out of there. So for me, it was such a good experience. It's like, oh man, I'm back home. Well, how, this is different over here, you know what I mean? So but then it's good what you say, that, you know, you can go back at some point. It's just that the times are so different right now. And you coming from, I thought I was doing something being in two outbreak nations. You went from China to Italy to America. Like, you went through all the outbreak nations.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So thank you for your health and your safety. I don't know what you was thinking, but because I remember when we talked in China, you know, you was forcing me out of China, and here you are traveling. You're like a damn WHO doctor, a World Health Organization doctor, going to every country. I don't know what you was thinking, brother.
Yeah.
You know. All right, so look, so what we like to do here on the BPRC is we like to talk a little bit, and then we like to play a couple games. So I'm gonna let you play one of these games, and okay. The first game is called Blackout. All right, So let me just give you a little intro. Blackout. All right. So what you do in Blackout is because this is called Black People's Republic of China. Blackout is a game where I give you a topic and then you have to name as many Black people in that industry or in that career field as you can in 30 seconds.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So let me set the timer here for you so we can make sure your 30 seconds is legit. Here we go. All right.
Man, if I don't get one, do I lose my black card?
Yeah, well, you know what? I don't know. Maybe you might. It depends on what our viewers think. You know what I'm saying? All right. So let me see. What's the topic? So you're a pretty smart guy. So let me see what I could come up with. Okay. I'm gonna give you something easy. No, I'm not gonna give you nothing easy. Black artist.
What kind of artists?
Like painters, sculptors.
Painters?
Exactly. Okay, how about that?
I'm black.
All right. I'll tell you when to start. Okay, how about this? I'll give you something better, something easier. Black designers, fashion designers.
Black fashion designers.
Okay. And it could be old or new.
Okay.
All right. You're 30 seconds. Right. All right. So the record is 7.
Okay.
No, I'm sorry. The record is 9. DJ got 9.
Okay.
All right. You ready?
Yeah, I guess so.
All right. Go.
I think like him. Didn't he, Sean Collins, have some? I think he has some. Pharrell, maybe. I don't know. He had a clothing line. I remember.
You got four. So when you say, I'm gonna accept the names, but I was looking for the brands. But that's my fault for not saying the brands. So Diddy had Sean John.
Yeah, yeah.
Pharrell had Bape. Kamora Simmons had Baby Fat.
Yeah.
Russell Simmons had Fat Farm. So those are the four you got. And you said Serena, but I don't know.
I said Serena.
Yeah, but you said after the 30 seconds. So that doesn't count. You don't get no love for that. And I don't even know the name. What is her brand? I don't even know the name of that one.
I don't know. I've seen her advertising stuff before. I don't know her brand. I don't know. I just saw her advertising her lot.
All right, we're going to have to.
She was on QVC or something like that. I remember.
All right, we're gonna have to do Serena better than that. Let's see if we can. I'm all alone in this, so I don't have a fact checker. All right, I'll get to that later. But all right, let's go to the next one. You got two games, all right? Two rounds of games.
Okay.
All right. So the next game is let's see here. If I can give you the intro, then I'll explain the game to you.
There was apple,
A,
bacon,
B,
and cucumber,
C,
in the soup. There was duck,
D,
eggs,
E,
and french fries,
F,
in the alphabetical soup.
Okay, game is called Alphabet Soup. Okay, Alphabet Soup.
Okay.
Now this one, now this one may be up your alley a little bit more. All right, so what you got to do is I'm going to give you a letter, okay? And you have to say as many words as you can, starting with that letter. Pretty simple, right?
So you're going to give me a letter, and then I just give you as many words associated with that letter.
Yep, but you can't say any names.
Okay.
All right.
How many do I have to get? Just as many as I can say?
Yeah, as many as you can say. I can tell you, you want to know what the record is?
Sure, yeah, what's the record?
11.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to give you the letter H.
H?
H. Ready?
Uh-huh.
Go.
Pat, I, helium, Hector, homogenous, hero, happy, honest, heroism, honesty, happiest, happier, Helium, highway,
and
hope.
Okay, you're 30 seconds up, brother. And I like what you did there. I like what you did there. You used one word. You used about one word 8 different times. Okay, you just added this. Yeah, you was like happy, happier, happiest. That is funny. Okay, so yeah, man, you did good, man. You got 15, which is the new record, and you know, I like your intelligence. This is why I say you're a doctor, because nobody else thought to reuse the words, right?
Yeah.
Serena Williams.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
I didn't know. I would never.
Yeah, me neither. So, that's good to know. But yeah, brother, man. So I appreciate you being on the show, man. If you'd like any parting words, man, you'd like to say, introduction, any handles, how to reach out to you, anything you wanna promotions you wanna give, go ahead and do that now.
I just want to say, I know we're in this difficult time, and I just say, to people that are, stay positive, don't focus as much, there's so much negativity and so much, doom and gloom, and I think this is an opportune time to, really see what's important in your life, a time to restart things, and also a time to, grow closer to God. And also another time to, I say, to get through these times, you need to focus more on filling yourself with positivity, optimism, and hope, and not focus as much on all the negative press, but focus more on the positive things, keep your spirit uplifted. So, I thank you for the opportunity to show, and now, I'm going to take care of you, praying for you, and stay safe, stay healthy, and yeah.
All right, brother Marcques, good stuff, and God bless, and we'll be talking soon, man. I'll get with you later.
All right, man, take care.
All right, thanks.
Bye.
Okay. Yeah, so that was Dr. Marcques, an inspiring doctor who will be a doctor very soon here. He also lived the experience with me in China, so it was good to hear his perspective. But enough of that talking. You know how we do here at BPRC. We do a little bit of talking, then we do a little bit of uplifting. Let's raise it up a little bit and give me some pick me up tunes. This is Jack Harlow.
What's poppin'?
Brand new whip, just hopped in. I got options. I can pass that bitch like Stockton. Just joshing. I'm spending this holiday locked in. My body got rid of them toxins. Sports in the top 10. I can put the ball in the end zone, put a bad bitch in the friend zone. This shit sound like an intro Jet song, give me that tempo. Told Pooh he a fool with the shit. Told her don't let her friends know. In the Ville and I move like a dime. Eating fettuccine or Vincenzo's. Me and my amigos got that free smoke on the West Coast. Yeah, I'm talking about pre-rolls. Dark hair bitch and she look like she go.
I'ma let this one go a little bit longer.
Feeling myself, can't murder my ego. She heard of my deep stroke. She said, "Babe, does it hurt when
forget
I
forget that we just had a lecture?"
Certified freak hoe, hang around dust.
And just kind of enjoy the mood a little bit.
Wasn't worried about me though. In the gym, trying to work on my free throw. God
damn. Jack Harlow.
Spending money at the club like Sam's. Yes, ma'am. She a little freak on cam, but she don't put this on the ground. Little boys trying diss on the ground. Hey, I can't switch on the fan. Shit's hot, hit the switch on the fan. This where my head is. I feel resentment from every direction. Even some homies be wearing expressions.
Good, 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 good. We back. So, Again, the topic is integrating society. And just to wrap all of that up, I like to talk about restrictions a little bit. The restrictions of integration, being restricted on how to find where you belong, you know, in terms of be in the quarantine now. So it's easy to get back into society and say, okay, I got to find a job. Let me go online. Let me go to these stores. Let me get a car. Let me drive around. Let me go meet people. Let me go here. Let me go there. And just kind of find your niche a little bit, right? But in these unprecedented times of quarantine, you're restricted on finding yourself, you know? You can network by online, but you have to learn how to do that, right? So you can't just go out to the bar or, you know, go out to a restaurant and just meet people, you know, or go out walking. Even if you do go out walking, you can't go anywhere that's crowded. You know, you can't go anywhere and just talk to someone because you have to do social distancing, right? Which is 6 feet apart. So you can't travel. So it's not like you can go to another city to see your friends or to see what's shaking, even apply for a job in another city because you probably can't even make it for the interview, right? Or just travel to clear your head, you know? So being restricted is... it's quite an elusive thing, and it's not really thought about because, again, these are times that no one ever imagined. So as an American, the land being part of the land of the free, I never thought I'd be restricted on anything I could do. That's just not our mentality. Nothing. You can't stop me from doing whatever it is I want to do. You can try, but I'm just going to find another way. Right. And I guess I still have, or we should still have, that same mentality. But there is just some things you just cannot do, period, in the outbreak, in the pandemic. Right. So that's my view on restriction, you know, even taking it further, being restricted with family. You know, you can see family, but you can't really spend time with family. During these times, you know, you can go see them, but then you got to worry about, am I transferring this virus to them? You know, you have to treat them as a stranger, basically, so that you don't give them the virus. You know, you can't hug and show affection to your family members. So you're restricted on all counts, and, you know, finances, you know, banking, grocery stores. So integration is really restricted during these times, and I'm finding out that it's a lot easier to be quarantined when you've been established in the country already versus moving to another country. So it's almost like it would have been easier to stay in China and ride this out because I'm already set up for everything. So when things get better, I can just go back to it, you know, versus moving back home. And you're not really set up for everything in terms of, you know, your banking and transferring funds and, you know, just federal grants and just things you just haven't been doing for the last few years, however long you've been gone, you know. So that's that, man. I wanted to wrap it up with being restricted for integrating society. And, you know, like me, you know me, I love roller coasters. So, and I love music. So we're going to go into Fresh New Finds. Now is going to be C-Town. I believe the artist name is C-Town. And it is by Chris K.H., Tommy Will, featuring Tommy Will, Stuns and Lins. Check it out. Tell me what you think. BPRC, Fresh New Find, C-Town. We love vibes here. Good conversation. Better, man, I stay up in the water like a drip, 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 drip. Smoking the tip shit, all competition, getting on this shit. Okay, yeah, couldn't find the key, so I learned how to pit lock. Get up in a hole, and I spin it like a pin drop. I'm getting better, better, swing, look at me. I'm doing things that you want to achieve. Being big G, got a guy, no fees. How you 10 toes down, you ain't got no
feet. What you gon' chase? You ain't got no dreams. I'll be down for the tell you can't stay in your seat. Your grass in the yellow, mine's greener than green. You chasing the cloud, but I bleed for the steam. I'm getting so anxious, I live for the shit. I'm lifted as hell, cause I stuck on my pick. Seen them all drop and I seen them all quit. Looking at cars, so we back in the shit. Look at my city, I'm proud that we lit it.
Yeah, enough of that. That's C-Town. You know, just a little, I like the little track on that, so a little pick me up there. Shout out to them. So now it's time for List It. We are going to, this is the part of the show where we create or we read off a list of something. And today's list is 13 ways to overcome negative thoughts. You know, I always want to try to instill positivity in my voice, in my passion, in my show. You know, so some way, shape, or form, man, something is going to come back to positivity some way, shape, or form, right? Love and light. So 13 ways to overcome negative thoughts. The first way, you have daily negative thought time, right? So which means allow yourself to have negative thoughts during the day, but put it in a box. Only allow a certain amount of time for those negative thoughts, and the rest of the day you don't have them. The second thing is replace the negative thoughts. So whatever your negative thoughts are, make sure you replace them with positive thoughts, right? So you can get it off your chest, but then you replace it with something that can sit with you or stay with you. The third one is be your own best friend. I can't reiterate enough, man. Like, no one's going to love you the way you love yourself, you know? So treat yourself better than you treat anybody else. Write instead of think. So whatever you're thinking, if it's negative, write it down. Sometimes I find personally writing helps me a lot. I love to write, but and I don't mean like write paragraphs, just write something, right? Don't think it, write it down. And that'll also help you with your memorization, right? And your focus. Fifth thing, make a conscious effort to find things to love, like, and appreciate. So it's what we try to do here on the show is spread a lot of love and appreciation. I appreciate any listeners to the show. You got to spread love, man. You got to spread love to receive love. And that just means being good to people, you know. And there are people, of course, who just don't want to be good. But even them, they want to be good. They just don't know how to be good, right? That's just not how we're wired as humans to be evil people, right? Well, something turns us into that. Six, ask yourself some tough questions. Again, these are ways to overcome negative thoughts. So if you have negative thoughts, then you ask yourself some tough questions. It'll remove the negative thoughts because your mind will start to focus on answering the questions you just asked yourself. Seven, establish new habits, right? Do something different, right? Change your routine because that's one thing is we can get bogged down into the same routine or the same habits. And then those habits become boring. And then we start blaming those habits for not bringing us success because we've been doing the same thing and it becomes boring. So we don't see the progress. Number eight, stop watching the morning news. I'm a big fan of this because one, you know, you can only get so much truth from the news. I do believe that you should watch the news, but not a lot of it, you know, because it's nothing. They don't really put anything positive on there. Number nine, use affirmations. Continuously tell yourself good things about yourself. You're wonderful, you're skillful, you're thoughtful, you're loving, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Number 10, develop your success routine. So map your day out, at least map your morning out of how to start your day and try to do that every day. How to recharge your battery in the afternoon. How to go to bed with positivity and, you know, maybe three different phases of your life is how you should set up your success routine, you know. The 11, channel those thoughts into something constructive. Whatever negative thoughts you have, figure out how to turn them into something that can build you or build you up. Number 12, focus on gratitude. It's pretty self-explanatory, right? If you're focusing on gratitude, then you can't worry about attitude. Number 13, try movement and meditation. You know, our bodies and our minds are like computers, man. We're like the earth, man. You know, the earth needs sunshine in order to feed us with nutrients and organic materials, right? So we need to shut down and supply our body with with meditation and peace and just moments of clarity to recharge and keep pushing forward. And what movement does is releases a lot of negative energy inside so that you can keep receiving and it doesn't build up, you know? So that's our 13 ways to overcome negative thoughts. That's our list for today's show. And again, we always like to leave on a positive note, on an uplifting note. This is our good vibe song of the day. And I believe it's called Lately. It is by the artist known as Forrest. To sum up today's show, man, the basic. Oh, here we go. Lately by Forrest.
Yeah, I gave him a ride home because
just a good vibe feeling. Be sure to love yourself. Be sure to do whatever you have to do to integrate into society. And love life, love yourself, love your family, stay safe, take the virus serious, and enjoy, travel the world, BPRC, experience across the waters, and I'm out.